closing out our day is Dr. Jay Sexton. He is the inaugural Rich and Nancy Kinder Chair of Constitutional Democracy and a professor of history at a spectacular university, if I must say so myself, the University of Missouri. He is a native of Salina, Kansas, and a diehard fan of various Kansas City sports teams. And Dr. Sexton is the former director of the Rothmere American Institute at Oxford University, where he was a distinguished fellow of the RAI and an emeritus fellow of Corpus Christi College. His research focuses on the United States and its economic and political relationships with the large empires of the 19th and early 20th centuries. His most recent books are A Nation Forged by Crisis, A New American History, which explores how America's history has been shaped by international forces, and Crossing Empires, Taking U.S. History into Trans-Imperial Terrain. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please put your hands together and with me, welcome Dr. Jay Sexton.
Well, thank you very much, Laura. It's always great to be here at the World War I Museum. As you just heard, I'm from around this neck of the woods. I didn't hear any applause about the University of Missouri, so I'm taking we got no Tiger fans. A couple Tiger fans in the audience. Do we have any KU Jayhawk fans in the audience? Okay, well then, I'm afraid I'm gonna have to wear my other hat, Laura, not as a Mizzou professor, but as an alum of KU. Where I went as an undergraduate, and now I've made the Missouri fans upset. The KU fans are already upset that I'm at Mizzou, so everybody's upset with me. And those beaming in online probably have no idea what we're talking about internal Kansas City stuff, so I apologize. Okay, so what I'm going to talk about today is, I suppose what I want to do is I want us to step back a little bit, step back from the specifics of the Great War of 1914 to 1919, step back both chronologically, taking a broader sweep, but also step back from the United States itself and ask a question, what is the significance of the Great War era, the World War I era, to the development of the United States? And what I want to argue today is that World War I ushers in a new era in American history, and it does so not so much by fostering internal changes in the way in which the United States structures its politics or organizes its power or engages in that long-running quest for social equality. Those things are all happening, but they're kind of happening all the time in American history. Rather, what I want to suggest is that the most important thing that is happening is that the Great War accelerates shifts in the position of the United States in the wider international system. We're going to take an external view of American history and argue that the position of America in the world really changes, and it really changes in part as a result because of World War I itself. And we're going to look at three specific dimensions of this. Perhaps some of them will be familiar, perhaps some of them won't be. First, we're going to look at finance, where America sits in the international financial system. Second, we're going to look at migration patterns, global migration patterns. And I use that word migration rather than immigration, because, of course, what's happening in this period of time is a global phenomenon of laborers moving around and crossing borders. Migration patterns certainly change as a result of World War I. And then third and finally, we're going to look at foreign policy and how the United States, in official terms, chooses to relate with other governments, other markets, and other peoples. And the argument is that, you know, if we take a long view, a lot of the changes that are brought on by the Great War, World War I, are long in motion. Okay, they're changes that have been in the works for decades. But what happens is World War I accelerates those changes. It's the great accelerator of the changes that have been in motion, and everything looks different thereafter. Though I do want to have a qualification here, and we'll come to this point at the end. The qualification is, it's not as if America's position in the world has been settled or tidied up in 1920. There's still a lot of lingering questions, questions which really smart people are going to be grappling with for the next couple of decades. But the structures, the structural changes have occurred, and they've occurred as a result of World War I. I don't know if we have our first slide on the PowerPoint up here. So that's the title, and I guess I want to say one more thing, and that is, I'm going to call what follows World War I the exceptional era in U.S. history. And I'm using that word, I suppose, to kind of be playful, because that's a word we often use today about exceptionalism, but not in the sense that we debate about, is America exceptional today? That tends to be an assessment of how we would qualify America's nationalism today. You either think we're exceptional or you're not. I'm actually thinking about an exceptional era when America's position in the world looks very different than it does for what comes before, and indeed, what comes after the Cold War. 1920 to around about the 1980s is an exceptional era in how America relates to the wider world, and that's the point with which we're going to conclude. Oh, and in small little things, as told through the careers of three Americans. So I give lectures at the University of Missouri, and every semester, students are like, we love hearing about these like structural forces of history, but we want to hear stories about people. So we're going to hear stories about three people as we're talking about these changes. And here is our first person. I would say, do you know who that is? But I guess it's written on the slide. J.P. Morgan. More on J.P. Morgan in just a second. But the point here is global finance. Where does America fit in the international financial system? Well, before World War I, America has a very peculiar, indeed a very privileged position in the international financial system. America is the world's greatest debtor nation. It's the world's greatest debtor nation, certainly after the American Civil War, from 1865 to 1914, more capital that crosses borders goes to the United States than anywhere else. And indeed, in many years, and indeed in some decades, more foreign capital is going to the United States than all other markets combined. So the United States is something akin to a vacuum, or if we have any British listeners, a Hoover that's sucking up capital from abroad, sucking up capital also at relatively low rates of interest. So America gets both a high volume of foreign investment, but it gets it at a rather cheap price. So if you were to look at the London Stock Exchange in the 1890s, you'd find that American securities could be had for lower interest rates than could securities from other nations. Now this is a really important story to the dynamic economic development and industrial growth of the United States in the late 19th and early 20th century. A foreign capital underwrites all of the things that we often think of as America's national development. The railroads, for instance, a railroad investment from abroad, very significant to understanding how America has the world's greatest railroad system in the late 19th century. It's because it's paid for by cheap foreign capital. And indeed, you could make this argument more generally about America's growth having as much to do with its position in these financial markets as it does to do with any type of its internal organization. There is a shift over time in the late 19th century where foreign capital at first is going into public entities, it's going into national debt, it's going into state debt, it's going into municipalities. But by the end of the 19th century and in the days running up to the First World War, foreign capital is going into private hands. It's going into private hands, not into public coffers. And this leads to a new concentration of wealth in the United States. We all know, I'm sure, the golden rule. He who has the gold makes the rules. And people that have the gold are people like this, J.P. Morgan. J.P. Morgan, the archetypal American financier of the pre-1914 era. Now, we're familiar with thinking about Morgan as a specifically American character, right? He has his Wall Street bank, he builds his financial empire, he consolidates wealth and power, particularly in the railroads he manages. What we're not as familiar thinking about is that Morgan's wealth comes from his position as a privileged conduit for foreign capital into the United States. Indeed, his biography is quite interesting. He grows up, most of his childhood is spent abroad. His first job is as an intern at his father's investment bank in London. He's an intern at a very powerful Atlantic investment bank. He only moves back to the United States during the days of the Civil War, where he makes his initial fortune on government contracts. But thereafter, he amasses that fortune and grows it through the profits that he makes from funneling in foreign investment into the United States. And here's the numbers tell the tale. The millions of dollars of foreign investment in the United States is growing exponentially after the Civil War. On the eve of World War I, world's greatest debtor nation, over $7 billion in debt overseas. And here we arrive at World War I. And World War I is the spark that changes this long-running dynamic. And it changes it with remarkable speed, and unforeseen speed. Now, there were many before World War I, including Morgan himself, many who thought that the days of the United States as a debtor nation were coming to a close. And they would point to new phenomena. They would say, hey, look at U.S. export, capital exports, in particular to places like Central America and the Caribbean. That's growing in the late 19th and certainly in the early 20th century. Morgan could have pointed to his own banking house as an example of this phenomenon, and as an example of also funneling American capital across the Atlantic back to Europe. Little known fact, the first U.S. loan to a foreign government brokered by Morgan's father, J.S. Morgan, was to France in the Franco-Prussian War in 1870. This is a sort of forerunner, a precursor to what's going to happen in 1914. And indeed, J.P. Morgan does something similar when he loans the British money during the Boer War in South Africa, a decade or so before World War I. So there are portents of this, but nothing to suggest this monumental, epochal reversal of financial flows across the Atlantic. The process begins almost immediately in 1914 when the war breaks out. It begins first through voluntary British repatriation of its overseas loans. So British investors realizing the crisis that lays ahead, also realizing the fact that the British government needs funds, start to call in their foreign loans in 1914, bringing the capital back. Quite interesting to note, this had happened before in certain financial crises, and it had always been very destabilizing to the American economy. But the American economy stood up rather well when this happened in 1914 and 15. But by the time the war starts dragging on, something else begins to happen, and that is that the British government in particular, but the European governments come calling to American banks for loans. This happens in 1915, this happens again in 1916, multiple times actually in 1916, the British Treasury is coming to the House of Morgan asking for loans, and by the end of 1916, there's a solvency crisis where the British Treasury is on the verge of bankruptcy, dependent for the first time on American finance. The roles completely reversed. And by 1917, a kind of really important monumental date in financial history, the United States changes its position on global flow charts from a net debtor to a net creditor, and that position will move rather exponentially in the coming years. Now, what's the legacy of all this? Like, why does this matter? Who cares? Well, I guess I would just say that there's two things we need to think about why this matters. First, this was a really rocky transition, Think of taking that Hoover or vacuum and all of a sudden trying to turn it into a leaf blower. So instead of sucking things in, you're blowing everything out. The entire U.S. financial system had been constructed in a different era. Even something like the Federal Reserve System, 1913, cutting edge by the time of World War I, but had been designed in a different day and age, a day in which the United States was a net capital importer, and indeed, American national banks not allowed to own foreign subsidiaries under the original 1913 Federal Reserve legislation. Those sorts of things need to be changed. So there's an amendment to the Federal Reserve Act, I think, in 1916, and again in 1919, the EDGE Act, which allows American banks to start to establish overseas subsidiaries to bring some kind of order and control to the exportation of capital. You see something happen on a micro level within banks themselves, within old financial partnerships that had spanned the Atlantic, trying to adjust to the reversed flow of capital. You also see a rocky transition, of course, in U.S. politics and political culture. A lot of Americans and a lot of American politicians don't really like this new development. Now, they hadn't, to be sure, they hadn't liked being a debtor nation, but they don't like being a creditor to foreign nations and foreign markets that they are not sure are going to repay the loans. And of course, debt politics becomes a really combustible issue in U.S. domestic politics in the 1920s and again in the 1930s. You think of something like the Johnson Act, not normally mentioned in that run of events of neutrality legislation and isolationism in the 1930s, but a really important one. The Johnson Act says, you know, any foreign government that defaults on loans to the United States is not going to be allowed to raise more capital in the United States. Johnson Act of 1934. So you have this rocky period of transition. But underlying that rocky period of tradition, or the big trend line, and this is my second point about why all this matters, the big trend line is that this new position of the United States as creditor necessitates all kinds of involvement in international politics and affairs. That the United States, with its privileged position before 1914, sheltered by the power of the Royal Navy, and of course, sheltered by Britain's management of the global economy and gold standard and so forth, now the United States is getting entangled in foreign affairs in new ways. And of course, many at the time would have read intervention in 1917 in economic terms, that it was part of this new entanglement, and they would have seen the politics on the international stage of the 1920s and 30s in that way as well. So if you want to understand how America takes global leadership of the financial system in the mid-1940s, the Great War is the essential starting point. So that was my first figure, and that's J.P. Morgan, and of course, J.P. Morgan grows up in London. He dies right before the beginning of the First World War. All of this he might have anticipated, but wouldn't have foreseen the speed at which this change or these changes unfolded. Okay, second thing. U.S. and a global migration. I guess I can't ask if you know who this is for our trivia question, but did folks recognize Francis Perkins? A couple of hands. Francis Perkins always strikes me like the most important New Dealer, the most important politician of which you've never heard, or which is rarely celebrated. And I think absolutely worthy of celebration and of our attention. Very, very significant figure. More on Frances Perkins and her quintessential American tricorn hat she wore all the time. More on that in a second. But we're going to get to Francis Perkins through global migration. Global migration. And here, in some ways, we see a similar story to the story we just saw with U.S. finance. And again, the numbers tell the tale. Once again, America, 19th century America, is that Hoover, that vacuum, sucking in this case, not just capital, but labor from around the world. The United States is the favored destination for border crossing migrants in global migration patterns from 1850 all the way until 1920. Okay, so the United States gets more immigrants than any other nation in this period. And there's a lot of competition, including East Asian migration, which we shouldn't write out of the story, migrants crossing borders in East Asia in large numbers, but still more are arriving in the United States. Now, migration before the Civil War was, of course, also a significant phenomenon, but it was limited. It was limited to migrants from the British Isles, including, of course, Ireland, and from continental Europe, most of all from Germany. So those of us from Missouri will know there's a significant surge of migrants from Germany in the mid-19th century after the failed revolutions of 1848. That's why we have Herman, Missouri, and we have this wine industry in mid-Missouri. We'll also know, of course, about Irish migration, especially if you're from St. Louis. What happens after 1865, after the Civil War, is that the nature of migration changes, and it changes in two ways. First is just the sheer volume of migrants that come to the United States begins to pick up. And you see the sheer volume, it goes up. These are large numbers, but it's not on a consistent trend line. Migration patterns very closely map on to economic downturns. So the reason why you don't have many migrants in the 1890s is you have an economic downturn. You'd think that would bring a lot of migrants to the United States. Well, it's the United States that has the economic downturn, and there might be more profitable destinations for migrants to choose to go. And it might also be more difficult for those migrants to afford the transportation costs to get from point A to point B. So it's an irregular pattern, but nonetheless, in its volume, in the sheer number, there's nothing in the earlier period of the United States along the lines of this sort of number of migrants in the late 19th century. The percentage of the population that is foreign-born in the United States peaks in 1890, the 1890 census, just a little bit below 15%. Okay, so its scale is new, but what's really different is also the diversity of these migrants, their makeup, where they're coming from. And they're coming from regions far beyond just the British Isles and from Germany. This is the era, of course, of migrants coming from Eastern and Southern Europe, from Italy and Greece in particular, from Poland. This is the era of Jewish migration from Eastern Europe to the United States. This is also an era of trans-Pacific migration across the Pacific, when you have large numbers, in particular, of Chinese laborers coming to the United States. So the diversity of the populations is rather new. Now, Francis Perkins is born in 1880, so that's why I started this chart here. Born in 1880, born into a established, wealthy New England family. She traces her family tree all the way back actually to the 17th century. She has ancestors participating in the American Revolution. She is a sort of white Anglo-Saxon Protestant, but becomes a champion of both immigrants and laborers in her early career. She studies economics. She studies science. She's very interested in statistics. And does some of her first work as a young woman at Hull House in Chicago. I don't know if anyone's ever heard of Hull House in Chicago, but a beacon for reformers like Perkins, a beacon, a place where educated middle-class reformers, especially women, would go. And they would go there to help immigrants adjust to the new industrial realities of Chicago. Whole House is in Chicago. And Perkins saw, what I'm trying to spit out here, is that Perkins saw immigration and labor as one and the same. That these weren't two separate issues. But the questions about labor in early 20th century America were inherently questions about immigration. And of course, though we like to think of immigration as being an ideological act, that immigrants are coming to the United States because of its a political system or because of its religious tolerance, and of course there's examples of that, but by far and away, the largest number of migrants that are coming here, especially in this period, are laborers. They're laborers and they're reacting to shifts and changes in the international economic order. This is the high tide of early industrialization and the globalization of industrial capitalism. What Perkins was struck by was the relative weakness of the American working class, the American proletariat. She was struck by how American workers, immigrant workers in particular, were exploited. So one of the things that she did, her big job at Hull House actually, was going to employers, factory bosses who had withheld wages from female immigrant workers and trying to get those back wages for the workers. The lesson there was that the workers themselves were unable to federate, were unable to advance their interests in unions, were unable to do so through the political system, and Perkins wanted to change that. And we might pause here at one of those classic old questions in American history, which you might have heard before. Why is there no socialism in the United States? Why was there no socialism in the United States? I think any serious answer to that question must begin with the ethnic diversity of the American working class, which divided it, which made it very difficult for workers to come together, to cross cultural, indeed linguistic lines, and to federate into unions. And that was what Perkins was working at doing in her early career at Hull House. She was also a witness to one of the greatest workplace tragedies in American history, the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire. I don't know if anyone's heard of that. 1911, I think it was, in New York City. Almost exclusively an immigrant female labor force in a textile mill. In a shirt production, transforming textiles into cloth in New York City. All the doors bolted shut to prevent theft, also to prevent agitation from communist labor organizers. That's why they would bolt the doors. And then when the fire started, no escape route for the workers. Perkins was happened to be on the street, watching the workers jump to their deaths when they couldn't get out of the building. Okay, so pre-war, what I'm getting at here, high immigration, extremely high immigration in the United States, immigration which is fueling the growth of the industrial economy through the additions of a labor force, but is also creating a peculiarly weak working class, at least in Atlantic terms, compared to the other societies. You think about the other combatants in the Great War, they're starting to have more organized and powerful working classes. Indeed, they have oftentimes working men's or working class political parties. One thinks of the Labor Party in Great Britain, which is starting to win elections at the very time that Perkins is making her case on behalf of American immigrants. So that's the pre-war story. What happens during the war? Well, what happens during the war is an abrupt cessation of immigration to the United States. And it happens in two ways. First is simply the turmoil and indeed the dangers in transatlantic shipping mean that fewer migrants are going to be crossing borders or even able to cross borders if they want to. So you see a quick stoppage of immigration beginning in 19, 14. Then when the war ends in 1919 and 1920, and in particular in early 1921, you see a rapid increase in immigration. You see a rapid increase in immigration. You see people fleeing war-torn Europe, thinking that there is no future in war-torn Europe, as the political instability, as you've just heard, is not resolved. Indeed, it's deepened after 1919. The economies are wrecked. Cities are in ashes, or some cities are in ashes. And the United States has this booming economy, like a magnet, drawing in laborers. So you have a rapid increase in migration in 1919, 1920, 1921, which fuels a correspondingly rapid increase in American nativism, in opposition to immigration. And this is the high tide of American nativism, American immigration restriction, is right after the Second or the First World War. Now, we know it's been around for a long time. We know that there was like this kind of weird, kooky know-nothing party in the days of the Irish potato famine. We know that in the late 19th century, there were opponents of Chinese immigration. There was opponents of immigration from Eastern and Southern Europe. They'd never really had the upper hand in American politics yet. One of the reasons why the federal government actually lacked the state power to patrol its borders, if you think about the Pacific, Angel Island, which is the kind of Pacific version in San Francisco of Ellis Island, Angel Island's not even completed until 1911. So though you have a Chinese Exclusion Act in 1882, the federal government actually doesn't have the power or the capacity to enforce it. One of my favorite statistics, least known statistic about trans-Pacific migration, is there are more Chinese arrivals in the decade after 1882, after that initial Chinese Exclusion Act, than there are in the decade before. Okay, so legislation and policy tells us something, but it doesn't really change what's happening on the ground. That's a different story by 1921. The United States, in part because of the Great War, wars lead to the centralization of political power. It's kind of a rule of thumb. They lead to more powerful governments that are able to do more things. And one of the things that the government is more equipped to do is to control its borders. There's now the political will to do so. The critical X factor is, of course, the fear of Bolshevism, the fear of the Russian Revolution, of subversive communistic Bolshevistic ideas infiltrating the United States via a massive immigration. And this is what tips the balance in favor of the immigration restrictionists, who first pass a temporary emergency piece of legislation in 1921, then pass a more sweeping and broader permanent immigration bill in 1924, which leads thereafter to the single period in American history where immigration rates are contracting and contracting very, very rapidly indeed. And the statistics again tell the tale. Now, my point in all this is a huge shift in how America relates to the world, okay? And it has a really unexpected, surprising legacy. The unexpected legacy is that it actually empowers labor in the United States when immigration restriction is imposed. Immigration restriction is the unintended catalyst of the creation of a powerful American working class movement. Indeed, I do not think that you get the pro-union legislation and actions of the New Deal unless you shut the borders off. But no one intended this. This wasn't the argument that was made. This was the unanticipated result. And I think there's two things happening here. First, from below, the American working class, no longer a subject to rapid change, demographic, ethnic change through new waves of immigration, the American working class gradually is becoming more of a national, integrated, proper class. And we see that in the 1920s, but then we really see it in the 1930s. Really interesting story how that happens. But then from above, we have the extreme makeover of the Democratic Party. The extreme makeover of the Democratic Party under people, you know, you always want to say under Franklin Delano Roosevelt, under Francis Perkins. Francis Perkins, before Roosevelt becomes governor of New York, Francis Perkins is by then an established figure, a pro-labor figure, activist, state official, state commissioner in New York labor affairs. And it's natural when FDR becomes president that he would appoint Perkins, first woman to hold a cabinet position, incidentally, in 1933. And Perkins, more than anyone, is the mastermind behind all that pro-labor legislation, the New Deal, the Wagner Act, which gives labor the right to organize. Social Security, she's head of the commission, which drafts the Social Security Act of 1935. She remains pro-immigrant. In fact, she's impeached in the late 1930s because she refuses to deport a labor union activist from California. He's actually an Australian. Refuses to deport him. It's alleged that he's communist. Probably is. She says, I've got no love for his political position, but I'm not going to deport him. The Department of Labor, incidentally, in those days, had vast authority over immigration policy, which shows how labor and immigration were viewed as one and the same. And perhaps one of the most significant things Francis Perkins does, Francis Perkins is one of the most powerful voices in the 1930s saying we need to expand our quotas to allow European Jews to flee the coming storm. Francis Perkins, that becomes one of her causes in the FDR administration as well. So it's a surprising legacy of immigration restriction. The Great War is a pivotal link in that chain. And when the United States becomes this new world power in the coming decades, it does so at a really peculiar moment in its history, a moment in which it is peculiarly pro-labor, more pro-labor in the 1930s and early 40s than the United States had been before, probably ever since. Also, the United States as a beacon of feminism. Perkins herself would be the exemplar of that. She has a role in crafting the American century. When the FDR administration joins the International Labor Organization, which is part of the Versailles Treaty in 1919, the United States doesn't join the ILO. It does in 1934. Perkins is the only female delegate at the convention. She represents the United States. She plays a key role in the drafting of the Philadelphia Declaration of 1944, which might seem as a forerunner to an important document crafted by another American woman, of course, the UN Declaration of Human Rights in 1948, crafted by Eleanor Roosevelt. Okay, so that's Frances Perkins' story, and our last one will be quick here. Kansas City people, we all know who this is. This is a picture we're probably not as familiar with. This is a young Harry S. Truman. A young Harry S. Truman, of course, part of the American Expeditionary Force that crosses the Atlantic after the United States joins the war in 1917. And what I want to talk about here is a similar reversal and shift, and that is American foreign policy. How's the United States choosing to relate to the international system, to other countries? Well, before World War I, we probably know, what's the trend line, what's the headline of U.S. foreign policy? Well, I would say that the headline of U.S. foreign policy in the 19th century and early 20th is it is just all over the map. It is just zigzagging, it's incoherent, it changes from administration to administration. It looks really strong and assertive in one place at one time. 5 years later, it looks completely different. We are so conditioned. We often want to think, give meaning and coherence to history and want to say, oh, America was an isolationist power in the 19th century, or America was just always an imperialist power. And we want to try to make a case like that. I think the exact opposite is true. Incoherence, indecision, ambivalence, zigzagging. That is the hallmark of pre-1914 U.S. foreign policy. Of course, when we take that perspective, we're not surprised that when the Great War, when World War I begins in 1914, not surprised that the United States is zigzagging, it's ambivalent, it's indecisive, it is internally debating how to respond to this international calamity, and only eventually gets dragged into the war in 1917. But those ideas, I think, persist after the United States, after World War I ends. Here is Harry Truman in one of his letters to Bess. I don't know if anyone has read Truman's letters to Bess. If we put a plug in for another Kansas City institution, the Truman Library on their website in Independence has all of his letters to Bess online, and you can read them. Really interesting. This is actually when he shares some of his most candid reflections, not just on his personal life, but on political affairs. Here's what he says in 1990. He doesn't give a crap. He doesn't give a whoop. Sorry. I don't give a whoop. I don't care. Of course, he's a young man. He probably just wants to get home. But I don't care. I don't care if Russia's got a red government or a purple one, a president of the Czechoslovaks. Who cares? Send me home. I would say that that's actually pretty representative of American views in 1919. And again, if you look at the Versailles Treaty debates in the Senate, there's the sense that, you know, it's the isolationists that are ascendant. I would say if you look at the process of how that treaty kind of winds its way through the political system, the headline there is there's opportunities to maybe ram a compromise through. Wilson doesn't take it. There's shifting coalitions. There's only about 12 to 15 senators that say, over my dead body, the irreconcilables, over my dead body will I vote for this. There's a possibility to get it done. It doesn't really get done. It looks very similar to how treaties are going through the Senate, really from the 19th century onward. Now that all changes. It doesn't change immediately. None of these changes are immediate. The Great War accelerates the processes in which structures adjust of how America fits into the world, but it doesn't determine policy outcomes. It takes a long time for politicians, for banks, for individuals to respond to the new context. And here, it really takes until 1940, and most of all of 1944 and 45, before the United States accepts the need to develop a coherent, rational, consistent foreign policy, internationalism. I'm going to get to Truman's farewell address in just one second, but first, Kansas City. Can we name these three individuals in the car? I think this is Potsdam. They're going to go meet with Stalin. Obviously, we got Truman in the middle. Eisenhower. Let's see. Omar Bradley, thank you so much. I'm shocked. Yeah, I just said Francis Perkins, forgotten character in the past. Omar Bradley from Moberly, Missouri. Omar Bradley, here he's just finished. He's been the commander of the 12th Army Group, the largest army under the command of a single commander in U.S. history. He's soon to become the first director of the VA. He's going to become the first chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. He's going to play a key role in the desegregation of the armed forces a few years later. He's going to play a key role in ousting MacArthur in the 1950s. Omar Bradley, one of the most significant 20th century Americans that you've never heard about, or I'm glad to say that you guys have. Striking that there's no like monument, memorial statue to Bradley in Missouri. I wish that would change. There is an airport in Moberly, a very small airport. Nothing against Moberly and its airport, but I think he's worthy of a bigger commemoration than that. And quite interesting, these are the architects of the American century at Potsdam, and they're all from between Abilene and Moberly, right here in the Midwest. But look what Truman's saying. This is his farewell address. This is where I'm going to end. His farewell address. I think one of the most important speeches of the 20th century, just as important in articulating America's place in the world for this era as George Washington's farewell address in 1796 when he gave it. We all probably know about that. Everyone celebrates that. That was an important articulation of how the United States should relate to the world in the age of monarchies. This is just as important for the 20th century. And what I want to emphasize here is that Truman is reading history in a certain way. He's not really talking about appeasement in the 1930s. He's actually talking about that period right after the First World War, when the young version of himself was saying, I don't give a whoop. I just want to go home. Let's disengage. Future Harry Truman looks very different, saying, we need to have a coherent foreign policy. We need to foster economic growth and stability, world trade. That is what we did at the beginning of the Cold War. He mentioned in this bit, but earlier on in the speech, he talks about the very first decision he made as president. The very first decision Harry Truman made as president was deciding whether or not to send a delegate to the UN conference to create the United Nations in San Francisco. Very affirmatively decides to do that. And then he talks about how he had misread and how the United States had misread its duties back in 1919. So, in conclusion, the First World War accelerates a series of changes that are in motion, accelerates them, and in so doing, ushers in this very, very interesting, peculiar, indeed, so far at least, exceptional era in American history, an era that will last roundabout to the 1980s. We can debate about that in Q&A. First component would be America as capital exporter, right? In the black, not as importer, not in the red. 1917 is when that changes. It's going to stay that way until the Reagan administration. I believe the date is in 1986, when the United States becomes once again a net capital importer, a position, of course, that we have continued to develop and consolidate in the years since then. We are once again one of the great debtor nations of the world, sucking in foreign capital, mostly from central banks in East Asia. So that looks really different where we sit in financial flow charts. Second, totally looks different in terms of where America fits into global migration patterns. After the First World War, after those immigration restrictions of 1921 and 1924, America has historically low immigration rates. The percentage of the population that is foreign-born is going to gradually decrease from its high in the pre-1914 period. It's going to decrease, I believe, off the top of my head, the all-time low is 1970. 1970, and the percentage of the population that's foreign-born in 1970 is around 5.5 to 6%. Someone can check me on that, but it's around about that. That's a big change. Now, of course, that's also not going to last. In the 1965 Immigration Reform Act, it doesn't have immediate effects. Doesn't have immediate effects, but it begins to reverse that trend. And of course, you have higher immigration in the 1980s and 90s, and then after the neoliberal reforms of the 1990s, NAFTA and so forth, you're going to have much higher immigration. And indeed, in 2016, America's percentage of the population that's foreign-born was approaching those all-time highs of the pre-1914 era. Not quite there yet, I believe 13.5%, but very different from 1970. And then third, internationalist America, building alliances, forging permanent partnerships, new international institutions like the UN, like the Bretton Woods systems, these new international bodies to bring structure and order to the international system with the United States presiding over it. That is a legacy. It's not a direct legacy of 1919. It takes a while to get there, but it is a legacy of the First World War. It takes until after the Second World War for that to be the case. Unilateralism, isolationism, still around, but fringe movements in American politics in the days of the Cold War. That would not be the case today. That would not be the case today. Post-Cold War America seeking to distance itself from its historic alliances and international institutions, isolationism resurgent. Yes, you probably think, oh, well, this is just one political party or the other. Actually, I see this as a trend that cuts right across the two political parties in this day and age. It looks different for Republicans than it does for Democrats, but you can see similar phenomenon happening. So exceptional America briefly exists in the mid-20th century, and perhaps today the lesson of the Great War for us in the United States is to look at how a society adjusts to structural change in the international system, what it got right and what it got wrong. Thank you very much.
Jay Sexton, thank you very much. We are always talking about the enduring impact and whether direct or indirect, it is spectacular to be having those conversations. Your first question comes from Zoom. What influence did the fear of loan defaults by the French and British have in Woodrow Wilson's declaration of war?
In the declaration of war?
Yes.
I think it had a role. I don't think it was the decisive role, but it's very true, and people were aware that the United States had put its chips on the table on the Allied side, the British in particular, but the French as well, tough times in their treasuries, and if they lose, then there's going to be a real set of financial problems. So that's the logic, that's the obvious logic. I don't see the evidence that that's like the decisive factor. I think it's known at the time, it's debated at the time. It's particularly a point that's made by critics of intervention, both at the time and I should say later on. I mean, you think about like the Nye Commission in the 1930s, you think about those who said the United States needed to be isolationist. That's one of the things that they'd point to, that if economically America got entangled, it would predetermine foreign policies. So it's a powerful critique. It lingers around. It's definitely a factor in 1916 to 1917. But I would, by no means would I say it was the decisive factor for why America intervenes.
Did the shift from debtor to creditor nation influence the decision of the, pardon me, not nation, but did the shift from debtor to creditor influence the decision of the United States to join the war in 1917?
Yeah, same thing.
I've heard that at the beginning of the World War I, there could have been some financial moves made that would have bankrupted Germany and knocked them out of the war. Is that true? Yes, no, and either way, could you expand upon it?
I would say probably not true. I find that hard to imagine. I presume that these are moves made not by the United States in the run-up to 1914, but moves made by other European powers. But again, I mean, boy, this is a topic which does attract quite a bit of historical conspiratorial thinking that either financial interests are controlling everything, or financial interests could control things and could do that. And I don't see that that's really the interpretive mileage to get out of looking at finance in history. I think rather it's to think about finance as an instrument and a channel of power, which nations can harness on behalf of particular ends and can also be harnessed against them, but it's one of many. So I think you'd always would have to put a financial interpretation of something alongside other factors. So I definitely think that would be the case with Germany in 1914.
And as we wrap our Q&A this late afternoon, I'm going to give a shout back to our teacher who had asked an earlier question today, which I am going to repeat now, which is if there's one kind of essential question that students today in an American high school could be learning or should be learning about America, foreign policy, economic interests, and World War I in the very limited time that teachers have to teach World War I, What's the one thing, what's that one takeaway that needs to be fit into that,
the
20 minutes?
That's such an awesome question from the teacher, and I take the point about it. There being limited time for them, and I wish they had more discretion to teach what they wanted in the classroom. But I would just say that the key thing to take away from all this is that America's position in the world is prone to these moments of volatility. It's not constant or static. And I mean, looking around the audience and myself, we all grew up in an era in which America's position was really unusually stable. You kind of knew what American foreign policy was going to look like. You kind of knew what the underlying trend lines, economic and otherwise, were going to be. And of course, there were crises here and there. But the fundamentals of where the United States fit in were kind of set. They're kind of baked in. Well, of course, that's no longer the case today in the early 21st century. And I think a lot of our volatility in our internal politics is actually a product of the instability of the United States in the position of the its position in the world. And to circle back to the Great War, surely the value of World War I for students today is that this is the moment when so much changed, and it changed so quickly, and for many it changed so unexpectedly. So the value is to think that A, structures matter, you know, financial flows, migration patterns, etc., structures matter, but it's also how did people at the time try to grapple and make their way through this volatile landscape. And First World War offers all kinds of examples of that. And I think those examples are actually of more value to us today in our era than, say, something like the Second World War. The Second World War, which took place in a very different geopolitical context, which is quite different than the one we have today. So I'm putting in another plug for the World War I museum there.
Outstanding. And whether you are a fan of Kansas University, the University of Missouri, you make both universities proud with an answer like that. Can you please put your hands together in a warm round of applause?
Thank you. And